is Lorraine Garrison. I am a school psychologist here in San Diego County. And I am also the co-founder and co-writer of books with littlebrainstorm.com. You can find our books under my name or my husband's name, Justin Tracy. We do books on social emotional learning. One of them is called The Very Hungry Maggot and First Day School of Jitters. And would love to hear from you, and feel free to take a screenshot of the QR code. And if you like what we're saying and want to contact any one of us, you can certainly contact us. So thank you guys so much for coming here and celebrating Indigenous comic books and pop art. I want to start off by giving some land acknowledgement to the Kumeyaay tribes. We gather here and learn their tradition here in San Diego County. And so if you have any questions about honoring native lands or how to do that, you can look at the hashtag honor native land, and there is a map. We have a lot to talk about today. I am going to just moderate and introduce everybody down the line. I want to welcome Mr. Aaron Cuffey. Is that how, am I saying it right?
Cuffey.
He is the chief creator officer of Native Realities Press and IndigiNerd Entertainment, co-founder and chief of operations of Indigenous Pop Expo, co-owner of Red Planet Books, the world's only Indigenous comic book shop, and the most foremost Indigenous pop culture and literature distributor. So any Indigenous writers, illustrators out there, he's the person to know. And you are from the, so you are Anglo Black, Montanook, and Shinnecock.
It's Montauk, Shinnecock, and Wampanoag.
Great.
All East Coast tribes.
All East Coast tribes. Thank you so much for driving in. All right. Next, we have someone who flew all the way from Guam. We have here Mr. Sunny Chargaloff. Let's see, what can I tell about you? You are a Chamorro Korean educator, freelance comic artist. You teach high school, is that correct?
High school art, yes.
And you have been published with Dark Reaches, so a comic book called Dark Reaches. You have an upcoming book coming up, comic book and anthology, I'm supposed, right? Yes?
Yeah, it's a horror anthology. It's actually the second volume. It's to be published. It's not ready yet, but it's something that we worked on and finished, and it's getting ready to get published.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And next on the panel, we have Dr. Stanley Rodriguez. He is a professor of Kumeyaay culture, history, and language here in San Diego County. So thank you very much for being here, sir. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And finally and foremost, we have Mark Nazal. And Mark and I have like bumped into each other so many times, and there's so many good things I want to say about Mark, and I don't even know where to begin. But Mark has worked on special effects for, visual effects for Gotham, Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Westworld, Lucifer. And now he has his own comic book, which I'm so excited to have him talk about and introduce on this panel. So I'm just gonna go ahead and leave this up here. So if you guys need any information, you can, like I said, contact us. But I wanna ask the panel, yes?
Small thing, if you just talk a little more into the microphone.
Okay.
Perfect.
Can you hear me? Oh, okay, look, and usually people say that I'm the loudmouth. All right, awesome. So, you know, I want to ask the panel, what's your experience like? So as you can see, Indigenous people around the world are not monolithic, right? So we all look different, whether it is from Guam, whether it is here in North America, whether it is in the Philippines or anything like that. So I want to ask the panel, if anyone, you know, chooses to answer, what's your experience like growing up as being someone that is not of the majority culture and not seeing yourselves represented in your experiences? Anyone?
Sure, I can start. You hear me, right? Growing up as a Native American, I'm sure some of you can remember back in the 60s, Native people were in a lot of movies, but we were vilified, we were seen as savages, people that needed to be exterminated. And they were able to change that narrative from, you know, us being bloodthirsty and taking away from the fact that we were invaded, that we were fighting just to survive. And these things were never really shared about, and they never really talked about those things. It wasn't until later on during the Civil Rights Movement that that narrative started to change. And a lot of that was even in the comic books at the time. And now we're seeing a paradigm shift, but that was some of the things that I went through.
Awesome. Now we've got the younger generation here. Aaron or Sunny or Mark, what was your experience? I mean, Mark, you're a third culture here, and can you explain what that even means?
Yeah, so a third culture kid is somebody who grew up outside of their culture. So a little background about myself. I'm Filipino, but I grew up in the Middle East, which then led to Australia, then led to here. And so really, that was really how or why we decided to create the types of stories that we wanted to do, because I didn't really see myself represented in a whole lot of ways. In fact, one of the projects that we just revealed earlier today was this character. Lorraine, can we kind of show that
yes,
really quick?
Yes, absolutely. I will
so,
go back to that.
This character that I started creating when I was in high school, like the character right there on the far left, The Fallen, it's a character based on my 17-year-old psyche that I created based on my thoughts and feelings, but somehow during that period in time, I didn't see or didn't have the courage to put my face in it. Whereas fast forward to today, we basically completely reinvented the character to not only have, you know, our features, but also chose an artist whose main characteristic is the ability to truly represent somebody who looks like they're people of color from their skin tone to their facial features. And that to me was extremely valuable, because if that makes me feel seen, that'll also make a lot of other folks like us feel seen as well.
And then can you tell me a little bit more about Carmina and the language that you use?
Oh yeah, so the other part that we, you know, we truly value as Duwata Comics is being able to truly put language where it belongs on page. What I mean by that is, yes, it's okay to say translated from, but we believe we should go further than that, where if we're able to put a fictional language like the Na'vi or the Jedi on screen, why not an actual living language and have the translations be there? I think people today are a lot more nuanced, that they would rather see and be able to even attempt to try to read it and then learn about it after the fact, instead of the hand-holding of just interpretation. So in all of our comics, depending on the title and depending on the mythology that the titles are based from, the actual Filipino language that we're deriving is written there along with subtitles in English for the rest of the world to understand.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that introduction. And then I'm going to bring it back to you, Sunny, because I have some of your titles here. And can you tell the audience more about Serena and what does that mean growing up on Guam?
Sure. Serena is a... Well, first, for those of you who don't really have any concept of what Guam is, Guam has been occupied by Spanish, Japanese, and U.S.
And the Russians, don't forget the Russians.
And the Russians throughout, like, so many generations. But Serena is something that was, it's a myth that and legend that was passed down from Spanish culture. What you see on the screen is actually a homage to... And a comic that I read, which was The Uncanny X-Men. And in place of that, I kind of swapped out something that was native to my culture, which was Serena, and I swapped that out with something that I read and I appreciated growing up. So the second panel there is, the middle panel actually is a, it's the current project that I'm working on. The horror anthology, I was actually asked to illustrate, but I pushed for a Guam writer to come on board, and they wrote a story that incorporated Guam culture and Guam myths and legends, and I was able to get that approved, and that was something that we used to try to promote Guam and Chamorro culture.
Awesome, thank you. Mm-hmm. And then, Aaron, can you tell me about, like, what's the, like, why did you feel the strong need to do all the wonderful things that you're doing right now? Let me see if I can go back to that slide. myself not being represented enough in conventions like San Diego Comic-Con, or what was that experience like for you?
Sure, it's definitely about representation. To echo some of what Dr. Rodriguez had said, my business partner and I, Dr. Lee Francis, who's my partner, felt after 30 plus years of both being huge comic geeks, genre fans, going to conventions ourselves as kids, etc., that we didn't see ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And the characters that we related to, there was always at least some aspect missing. And to us, realistically, at a certain point, it became, if we want to see it, we have to make it ourselves. And so the beginning was actually in the publishing part, was in the comics. It started with...
Did you start with the comic book store, or...?
No, just some single issues that really, for smaller conventions, it was do print runs of 150 copies of little anthology bits, 2 to 4 pages from numerous independent creators, all Native creators. The first iteration was called the Indigenous Narrative Collective, most of whom are still producing work independently today, a couple of whom are still working with us, and took them to the Denver... Comic-Con at the time, I believe Denver Pop Expo now, or Pop X, to conventions in Albuquerque, in Arizona, in Oklahoma, in Texas, just trying to generate interest and online. And
how long ago was that? Was that just...
That was about 8 years.
Oh.
It's been 8 years that we started from, again, 100, 150 single issue, 24-page copy print runs. Here, we hope you like it. Get back to us online. To now producing multiple graphic novels per year, kind of trending away from single issues for numerous reasons, but having the store, running the convention, wearing arguably too many hats, and it really coming from a place of, we don't see us, and we're not going to keep writing letters to Marvel or starting petitions and trying to burn DC to the ground. Let's just do it, because honestly, even with the attempts that any of the larger corporations make, whether it be in comics or anything else you can think of, and I'm sure many of you feel and understand this, it's either just lip service or they never do as good a job as they could. And even to the extent where some of them are doing what is arguably a pretty good job, a lot of the efforts that Marvel has done recently with some of their contract creators like Rebecca Roanhorse and Darcy Little Badger in Marvel Voices, in Legacy, and that permutating through numerous communities, it doesn't change the fact for those books, there are no Indigenous editors.
Mm-hmm.
There's no specifically Indigenous recruiter dealing with these artists or trying to find that direct narrative relation that makes sense. And even if you enjoyed the stories, and I enjoyed some of them because I'm a huge Marvel fanboy, it's still pan-indigeneity. It's still very non-tribal specific, non-culturally specific. It's still translated from, not this is the language, this is the history, this is what it means and why it matters. And for us stepping into that space and doing it and finding other people who are doing it themselves and trying to get it to the wider world is the only way.
Awesome. Thank you for doing that. I mean, that's a huge effort, and it's much appreciated, because voices do need to be represented. Thank you. All right, my question du jour, my question of the day for the panel. So what are some terrible representations, and tell me some good representations? And, you know, audience members, if you have anything, you know, shout out what you're thinking. And like the first one that comes to my mind is Tonto.
Sure.
Tonto. And so the struggle for that, right, to I mean, like, Tonto in Spanish means like stupid, right? And not a lot of people knew that. And the movement, I think of, you know, the civil rights movement, we finally like said, hey, this is ridiculous. So what are other some good and bad examples that you can think of, whether it's island, Filipino, and then what are some good examples that we should look at?
I've got a quick starter just because that picture is up there. If you look, not at me because I hate that, but in the top row above my head, you can't see it because it's just markered on our little plastic strip, but that actually says the Hall of Shame in our store. And just as I've been doing here, every time we go to conventions, we go to the booths that are selling, hey, get your bronze, get your silver age, get your old school stuff, and we look for fire hair, white Indian, scalp hunter, to buy them. And we'll pay whatever the prices from those booths and say, cool, no one is ever going to have this again.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We have a whole shelf of that type of representation.
Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. All right, you name some. What are some good ones?
Good ones. It's everything that they're producing. It just up, obviously,
yeah.
Some of the stuff that we've got out, like Hero Twins, the Tales of the Mighty Code Talkers, books like Ghost River, Dear Woman, an anthology. That's all us specific as a company. In addition, I think John Proudstar's work with Tribal Force is excellent since the 90s and now trying to bring it back. Keith Jim does a book called The Heroes. That's the shelf behind me is about 40 square feet of just native comics in our shop. So I'll keep going and I won't. Please dive in.
Yeah, how about you guys, island, Filipino representation, Kumeya representation, what are you thinking?
There's not a lot of representation, good or bad, in comics for Guam and Chamorro culture, but there was a recent Netflix movie that was produced and it was released, and it, although it wasn't specifically Guam, Guam and Saipan, if you guys know Guam and Saipan, it's still the same culture, it's Chamorro. And
it's
there was
the
a movie that came
Mariana's
out.
Mariana's Pacific Island area.
Right,
it's
so the language,
tiny.
the native language is the same, Chamorro language. A lot of our cultural practices are the same, but there was a movie, and I'd rather maybe not say it, or should I say it?
Is it negative or positive?
It was a bad representation of, they had like a local that was speaking, and even though he's speaking in English, the accent was really bad. It wasn't how we sound, and it was just a poor portrayal of Chamorro culture. Yeah, it was a weird stereotype that no one knew what it was. So very strange to make that choice.
There's a lot of military folks on Guam because we have four bases there, right? So I remember in elementary school, people would ask us when they would first arrive on Guam, because at the time in the 70s, they didn't have the education, and I would have students, you know, my peers my age would ask, you know, if I wore a coconut bra or if I had a toothbrush. I don't, you know, was it like that in the movie?
Yeah, well, actually, I mean, maybe not in the movie, but I mean, it was bad on that, what I spoke about, but those comments are still,
are they still
going around. I mean,
wow.
People talk about Guam, they ask, you know, about the huts and,
yeah,
you know, all those things that, you know, Guam is pretty modern now, but we still get those questions about grass skirts and coconut shells and stuff like that. So
what's some good representation of island people, you think? I mean, if it's not Guam, because Guam's not visible at this time.
You know, I'd have to think about that. It's so few and far between, so I can't really pinpoint anything.
All right, we'll come back to you. How about any representation in the Philippines or the Kumeya tribes or?
Well, I'll go back to the Westerns as far as like some of the worst things I've seen. I remember my uncles, my father, and my aunts bought my grandmother a black and white television. That was a big thing back then. And I remember sitting on my grandmother's lap. She was watching a cowboy and Indian movie. And every time those cowboys, you know, the settlers, they shot with a gun, five or six Indians would fall down. And I found out later from one of my friends who was a stuntman, he said, back then you got paid like $10 to go ride out there, but if you heard a shot and you fell down, you got paid $30.
Oh,
so
wow.
I said, every time they heard a shot, everybody fell off their horses. Got on. But anyway, in that movie, the man was saving two bullets, one for his wife. And he said, you know what would happen if those red devils got a hold of a white woman? And I asked my grandmother, what would they do to her?
Oh.
My grandmother said, probably marry her. But that was the mindset back then. And as far as some of the things that are coming out, some of the good things, I see a lot of things that are happening with comics in the language. And I liked what you said. Language and culture support each other. And being able to have that narrative where somebody can hear the language or see it. And as far as like the people I belong to, the Kumeyaay people, there's 4,632 Kumeyaay who reside on both sides of the border. Of that right now, there's 30 people who still speak the language. So under the UNESCO 9 factors of language vitality and endangerment, 5 being stable, 0 being extinct, our language is listed as 1, critically endangered. So by using this medium, you know, comics and other types of mediums in, you know, that are going on, these are opportunities to change that narrative, not only with language, but also with things that have been going on. You know, you're talking about how, you know, as social workers, some of the things that you've seen, ICWA, Indian Child, you know, Protection Act, NAGPRA, Native American Graves Protection Repatriation Act, all these things where comics can help to educate people on what's going on and instill positive role models.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think going with something that Sunny said that was similar, I think for us, there's not a whole lot, because I think from a cultural standpoint, we often get mixed with everybody else. Like, we've had a couple of different actors from people from our culture that usually get reappropriated into like Chinese or Japanese or anything else in particular. So while this character I wouldn't necessarily consider like bad representation, it was more disappointing representation. So Marvel's Wave, I know the Filipino community made such a big deal when that character came out, but when I finally read it, because she in theory was supposed to speak my mother's language, I read it and I missed that small part that said translated from Cebuano. And because I did, I said to myself, and even just by reading the character and how the character sort of like, you know, moves around in her world or communicates, I didn't really see somebody from, you know, my mom's side of the culture in it. It was basically an American voice. So if you're saying that this character is living on that side of the world with a very specific voice, well, number one, there's one line that says it's being translated from her language. Number two, the characteristics of how she behaves represent nothing from it. So I think going with, you know, what Aaron said as well, you have to be able to put it there because, for one, some languages are dying. In fact, for one of our titles that I will be giving one away today for, I didn't realize that language, which is my mom's language, was just a dialect, and it's not even written. There is no specific way that it's written as either wrong or right, because it's never written. It's always just spoken. So when we were writing it, I showed it to one of my cousins who grew up in that particular culture, and she said, actually, we never had textbooks on it. We just spoke it. It was never written. So there is no wrong or right.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Thank you so much for that. You know, so the reason why this is very important to me, I'm a school psychologist, and I have another friend of mine who's here in the audience who's a native school psychologist. I'm calling you out, Tiffany. And so representation matters because we want to break the stereotypes. Now, Native American kids and people between the ages of 15 to 24 have two times the highest suicide rate. So it's really important for us to capture us. Native American women here in the United States are 5 to 10 times more likely to go missing, and nothing is ever done about that. So these are really big issues and something that is near and dear to my heart as a school psychologist as I go in. And I forgot to mention that I am wearing all Dene jewelry by Native American artists, specifically from them. So thank you. And so I wanted to honor that because the difference between appropriation and appreciation is really learning about the cultures that are out there, that not all Native Americans, not all, you know, Filipinos even with the different islands, and not all island people are a monolith, right? So here's an opportunity to ask questions and to learn about the different cultures, you know, pick up that book, and, you know, traveling is a great way to learn about other people as well. But essentially, it's like getting to know other people will really support that and help that. Statistics by the Pew Research, and also that was with the Pew Research and the CD, I believe it's the Pew, I can't remember exactly, but in any case, when we look at our 100 friends, if we have 100 friends, specifically,
people who recognize themselves as being white will only have, only have one or two friends that are not white, as opposed to someone who's black or, you know, Indigenous or a person of color. You know, we have a whole mixture of different friendships. And so representation really matters so that we can understand the different nuances and understand, like, what people are going through. And that's how we do restorative justice in the school system. Are people familiar about what is restorative justice? Okay. I see a kind of sorta over there. Okay, so basically restorative justice is, it's not a punitive way of when you're arguing with someone, it's not like a strict rule. It's trying to understand the perspective of somebody else and understanding how you can make the situation better. One way of restorative justice is to be trauma-informed and understanding where that person is coming from. So, for example, is the audience familiar with adverse childhood experiences? Yes, okay, so I think I might have actually. So in adverse childhood experiences, there's three categories, abuse, neglect, or household dysfunction. CDC and Kaiser did a study together between 1995, over 20,000 people. They followed them, and despite culture and despite socioeconomic status or anything like that, if you had high ACEs, basically, any of these, you could have higher propensity of depression, asthma, heart disease, or anything like that. And so point being is that we need representation, we need to see who we are in within ourselves, and we need to relate to people and to understand and create that community so that we can support each other. Last year during COVID as a school psychologist, there was a lot of heavy mental issues that I saw. And a lot of it was because we've lost our resiliency and we have lost our communities. And the easiest way, as Dr. Rodriguez was saying too, is the easiest way is through this pop culture, is through comic books, for example. Has anyone here watched Reservation Dogs? Yes! Awesome. Aaron, can you tell me how that, you know, your connection to that?
No personal connection, so don't come asking me anything about the show. But we've known a number of the people involved in creating the production and just got super excited, really proud. Even Sterling, with the 1491s, the comedy and music troupe prior to taking off like a rocket, came to our first Indigenous ComicCon, was our entertainment there, and we had a lot of discussions about comics and stuff like that. I mean, to a certain extent, the entertainment, pop culture, all of these things, genre, I don't know if any of you are attempting professionally or are professionally doing it, but it's competitive. But on top of that, especially within the Indigenous community, at least the mainland North American Indigenous community, it's also pretty small and tight-knit. You may not know everybody or everybody's name, but depending on jobs, but anybody makes it or does something cool and big, you get excited. That's awesome. And Reservation Dogs was no exception. Like, we had a showing at the shop, still have the poster up that we got for us, like, hey, you guys should promote this type of thing. And we're like, hell yeah, we're going to promote the hell out of this, because anytime we can put something up that isn't Superman, Spider-Man, Invincible, whatever, we're like, yes, thank you, anything else. And that's really the closest connection. The other aspect is that I always refer back to, and maybe to not put a damper on anybody's fandom of it, but it's Lee and I, my partner, and I argue about it all the time. Part of what our focus has always been, like I said, we want to see representation, but the other side of that coin for us is, to go back to what Dr. Rodriguez was saying, we want to see a certain type of representation. You can still see Westerns where every Native person is riding a horse, wearing buckskin and fringe, and living in the woods. My family's people and tribes, as well as my partners, don't come from spaces like that. All my people were on the East Coast. Most of them were wiped out in the first wave of colonization. The people that are left are largely urban, are largely mixed with black people, so they either don't get recognized as Indigenous people at all because, oh, you're too black to be Native, or vice versa, and it gets really messy. They never had horses, they et cetera, et cetera. His people were Pueblo people in the Southwest, farmers, desert dwellers. They didn't go on raids. They didn't go fighting the colonists. Completely different perspectives on things, and the representation you see is that historicization or victimization. It's the two waves that you're largely going to see with Native people in pop culture, especially when Native people aren't in charge. Is they're either riding horses and fighting the U.S. cavalry, or they're living on the res and they're drunk and they're dying. And while these things are not unrealistic 100%, it's not the only thing that's there. There's a bunch of professionals sitting in a modern day convention talking to you that are all Indigenous people, added to the millions of others. And so Reservation Dogs is complicated because there's a lot of that reality and entertainment to it in the fact that these kids, again, my partner and I both taught in high school and middle school at Native schools. Those are our kids. Those mm-hmm. I know those kids. I taught those kids. I still talk to some of those kids. And at the same time, they're also not victimization porn.
Yeah.
Well, they're not. That's not all there is. It's
right.
Not just hustling to get through. Some of them have stable and steady and happy home lives. It's not just that it's all terrible. And while you can't deny one, I want to see the other too. Where's the rest of it?
Mm-hmm.
So that's my connection to Reservation.
Yeah,
Dogs.
Absolutely. Thank you. And it's a great representation in a sense, or bad in a sense, that not everybody wants to leave the reservation, right?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
So and it's the same thing with representation on Guam. Not I mean, like, I was one of those kids that wanted to leave Guam, but not everybody wants to leave Guam. Guam's a beautiful island, and oh, we've got 15 more minutes. We're being warned. All right, so this is where I give Mark the choice of, you get to choose who you're going to give your thing away, your comic book away, or what I don't know what you have today.
Okay, so only because this is an Indigenous community culture thing, I'm giving a set of three, each representing three different types of mythology and two different languages within Filipino culture. So let's start with
questions from the audience.
Yeah, probably
maybe?
Questions from the audience.
All right. The first person that
pretty
makes
good engagement probably gets it. Let's make it easy, and I'll sign it after the fact.
Yep.
Too.
Oh, we've got our first person. Yes, feel free to line up and ask questions.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Tim. Well, I'm an enrolled member of the Seminole Tribe of Florida, so I'm very happy to be watching and listening to everything. My question is, as far as writing goes or storytelling, how do you deal with conflict?
Hmm. What kind of conflict?
It can be, you know, you versus yourself, you versus the culture, society, all of that. You know, when it comes to, if you're going to kind of put yourself into your own story, how do you decide, like you were just saying, Erin, it's like, I don't want to just always see the trauma or the bad parts of it, but how do we also include it, because it is a part of our history?
I can kind of start with that. Like, with a new character that we're introducing, I pretty much wanted, I told myself that because it took me so long to really put this character pen to paper, because I just didn't have the courage to do it at the time, I think how you find the conflict is finding what resonates with you the most and the memory that's probably the most impactful, depending on the type of story you want to tell. I know that's a very broad thing, but also you do want to choose specific moments, because when you're trying to, you know, you're a part, the stories are a part of us, no matter how you put it. But you choose specific moments that you think, like, would resonate a whole lot more, and then your hope is that somebody else is able to connect with it.
Sunny, Erin, do you have recommendations?
I'm primarily an illustrator, so
I think these questions are better. You know.
And I'll echo most of what Mark said. It's pretty broad. I mean, conflict is an essential in your story. It becomes a question of relevancy, of importance or value to you and the characters in the story. So despite what I am saying about trauma being sort of a one-note thing, it's the same as the trope of fridging. It's not like people in characters' lives don't die, but it's also not the sun that they revolve around. And that's really sort of where my mind goes when I'm dealing with a story is, okay, what exactly, why? Does this matter? Does it count? And in what way? Yeah, exactly.
And to make your characters rich and authentic, they have to be more than trauma. They have to have, you know, something more three-dimensional than just trauma. Trauma is just like the surface. So that's my recommendation. And next question. And do we have any more giveaways? I know that we have.
I have a bunch.
Oh, awesome. Hey, well, look at this.
The worst case, you're getting out of here with a postcard, so don't worry about it.
Yeah, and then we'll do that in the hallway, but, like, let's get that next question.
Let me just say, we really only have about, if we're doing all these giveaways, we have about 6 minutes for these questions, so let's keep them moving.
All right, thank you so much.
So knowing that sometimes it's really hard to see the stories that you want to see from your community, that you know that it's more than just people in buckskin, lots of sadness, how do you find yourself breaking away from those so you make sure that you're telling the other sides of the stories, the other parts, and including them? Because I know it can be hard when you see this is all we show, making sure you're breaking away from that and getting into the other meat, the things you would have been nice to see as a kid.
I'll go first and make it really quick. It's genre. It's that's what does it for me. It's sci-fi and it's fantasy. It's Indigenous futurism. It's Afrofuturism. It's go the complete opposite direction.
Yeah, and I think to kind of like add to that, you want your characters to grow, and therefore as they grow, they leave a situation that causes them to be in that stereotypical way. In fact, you're free to get one of the books, because in our story, the character does start in that traumatic situation, but the hope for the character is she somehow transcends that as she grows.
All right, thank you. Next question.
Hi, I'm gonna try and word this the best way I can. One of the biggest problems I have with certain types of representation is I feel like there's colorism in the industry. Especially recently with Ms. Marvel, with the live-action Avatar series, the Indigenous characters were much lighter than their original, yeah. And that was something that really bothered me. And I don't know if is all representation good representation? Should we be fighting for someone who is darker skinned?
Absolutely.
And kind of like, what do you think is the solution to that? I mean, obviously, but.
Wow. Okay. So come to my panel at the library. So this is what we're going to be talking about exactly in our BIPOC panel, the Black Indigenous People of Color panel. We are going to go over the four eyes of oppression. We're going to talk about the 15. I have one of the panelists here. So it's systemic, unfortunately. And some of that is our own implicit bias. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that we could go through and talk about, like how to issue that. Because, like, we have issues with amongst our own communities, right? I'm, half Vietnamese. I mean, we still think to this day that being dark means that you're a farmer. So that's a long struggle, but hopefully representation does matter, and then we'll see more shades, the beautiful shades of that we all are. Yes, next question.
Awesome. I feel like I want to answer part of that question too.
You come on up here then, right?
We will chat. my question is, I wrote it down so I wouldn't take tongue and then it's not opening. My question was around, like, what would you all, because you mentioned, trauma's not enough. What would you all say is responsibility, particularly to, like, those larger media or entertainment entities, right? What's the responsibility that they have when showcasing Indigenous representation? And then the caveat there is, what do you think should be scarce or lessened, if at all, as pieces of representation, because either it's been done too much or it's because it's too surface, right? Like, so what should they have to do in order to, really represent in a,
like,
in
what's a good outline?
Yeah.
All right.
For me, and I'll just say it in Kumya, it's kanapkwahan. And what that means is to tell the truth, a true narrative of what's going on. And If we take a look at the reservations were created to contain our people. They were the forebears of concentration camps, and now they're our homes. But this is part, when we take a look at this, looking at all of this that we see here in San Diego, this is our holy land.
Mm-hmm.
Our creation story, which takes 4 days to tell its entirety, talks about all these places and stories for each one. And to be able to teach that, San Diego has more reservations than any other county in the country. A lot of people don't know that. So, and also, I like my color too. I've been working on my tan now, I'll keep working on it. But you know, that we are proud people, that this is our home, and we're never gonna leave it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love your shirt, sir. I wish I had something to give you.
I designed it myself. So, I'm a Samoan creator from Aotearoa, New Zealand. That's why I sound like Korg. But pretty much, you talked about our experiences, our people not being monolithic, and Indigenous experiences are wide and varied and diverse. So in terms of representation, like, how do you kind of catch all the experiences? Because one of the things as a Pacific Islander that pisses myself and a lot of people off is when it comes to AAPI month, where's the PI?
Yes.
So it's that kind of thing. Like, I'd rather you just take the PI away if it's just going to be AA. You know,
absolutely.
So how do you kind of navigate that in terms of trying to represent all these varied people and experiences to make sure that everyone gets their say?
I have a sad answer to that.
Oh.
You don't. It's and I mean that in the most loving and frustrating way. It's because we're not a monolith.
Mm-hmm.
It's because that's the errand. I honestly think that's super cultural pressure on us. Them telling us, you have to cover it all. You get a month, or you get a comic, or you get a show, or whatever it is, and it needs to serve everybody because that's all we're going to give you. And that equation doesn't work. You can't listen to them. It's frustrating and sad because that means somebody's at the back of the line still. Somebody's not getting in yet.
And my two cents is that's why I had Sonny come here from Guam, and you know, he is proud to represent Guam here at Comic-Con. There's no other person from Guam here, you know, to represent Guam. And I think, you know, unfortunately, we are currently smooshed together, but this is why I'm talking, right, to make that distinction that we're not a monolith. You know, someone from Samoa is gonna be totally different. And so we do need to honor and recognize, like, all of these cultures are different. As a school psychologist, my thought is that we first have to work amongst ourselves and end colorism. Wherever the person who asked about colorism here, you know, we have to end that fighting and lift each other up, and the systems of oppression that we are dealing with, who's trying to give us, you know, just a tiny piece of the pie, right?
Yeah.
So great question. Thank you so much.
And to kind of like add to, you know, what you asked about based on what Lorraine said, it's not even just about specific cultures, it's going into even specifics. So there has to be story that's very specific to one particular area, even to the point of specificity, because otherwise, as Lorraine said, it becomes too much of a mishmash.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Next question, please. Oh, I'm sorry.
Hi, my name is John. My question is about do you see if there's a need to balance things like reservation dogs and Dark Winds, which I just finished, which I thought was an incredible show, with things like Yellowstone, which I didn't, you know, I watched like the first season of Yellowstone, but it had Indigenous representation, along with colonizer representation. So is it important to have more of both of those kinds of things, where you see more of just primarily an Indigenous communities represented, as well as Indigenous and non-Indigenous characters interacting on a regular basis as main characters?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm
totally
gonna, you know, I'm gonna jump in here a bit. The reason why I like Reservation Dogs so much, and you and I can talk about this later,
yeah.
But it has all Native, from production, writer, crew, everybody, actors, everybody. And that's important. Sure, it's only telling one side of the story, but this is good, because, you know, we have had so many production crews where there isn't, I talk about neurodivergency as well. So I'm gonna rag on a TV show for a little bit here called Love on the Spectrum.
Mm.
Love on the Spectrum has no representation in the crew. And it's infantile. It treats the people like babies, and I want to poke my eyes out. And so this is what. Oh, please wrap up. So this is what I love about Reservation Dogs, for example. So we need, and they make fun of the, you know, the colonialization of everything. But go ahead. I'm so sorry. We have
no,
to
no,
wrap
no.
Up.
I was just gonna say that. I feel like. It is also valuable to have a mixed representation, because that is a reflection of our world today. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Yes, yes.
Real quick, I just wanted to say I'm a big fan of Res Dogs. One of the writers, his father is a former chairman at Viejas, Anthony Pico. And when I seen Dark Winds, I really enjoyed the series. There were a lot of things going on. People were speaking Diné. The culture was vibrant. And you could see, although there were struggles going on, there were struggles within the community, and they were working it out. That's what I really enjoyed about that.
Yep. Thank you so much. If you have more questions, we'll be outside. We'll be, you know, we much appreciate. Thank you again, Comic-Con, for having us.
Have the giveaways for you outside.
Otherwise, the panel will be outside to speak. So if you want to speak to someone, don't rush the table. You need to
take a photo. Sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to take
it. All right.